تجري بنور في الحياة جديد.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الكريم. I'm from an organization called FOSIS, which is the Federation of Student Islamic Societies, an organization which represents over 100,000 Muslim students, and we have an affiliation of over 100 Muslim Islamic societies around the United Kingdom and Ireland. I've been around for over 49 years now, alhamdulillah. A real amazing legacy when it comes to looking at the history of FOSIS. And inshallah ta'ala, we will continue to serve ISOCs to the best of our ability. So remember us in your dua. With that, I'm going to hand over to the chair of this session, which is Brother Ibrahim, a brother from FOSIS, the outgoing president of Kingston Islamic Society. So bismillah, Brother Ibrahim. Jazakallah khair.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء المرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. All praise due to Allah Ta'ala alone. We seek the blessings of Allah upon all the prophets of Allah and the last and final messenger of Allah, the best of the messengers, the leader of the messengers, the imam of the messengers, Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. Jazakum la khair, brothers and sisters, for attending. Inshallah ta'ala, we will begin swiftly with our first session called Beyond the Pillars of Adab with our esteemed guest, Sheikh Haitham Haddad. Just to give a very brief introduction, mashallah, Sheikh is based in London and alhamdulillah has been studying Islamic sciences for more than 15 years and has a special interest in Islamic law and legal theory, having graduated with a BA in Islamic law. And he has recently went on to complete his doctorate in the doctoral thesis in Islamic jurisprudence in reference to Muslim minorities. I will leave you with our Sheikh wa jazakum al khair.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala ashraf al-anbiya'i wa al-mursaleen nabiyyina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam tasliman kathira. We will go through the basic explanation in a very thematic way of Surah Al-Hujurat.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تقدموا بين يدي الله ورسوله واتقوا الله إن الله سميع عليم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا ترفعوا أصواتكم فوق صوت النبي ولا تجهروا له بالقول كجهر بعضكم لبعض أن تحبط أعمالكم وأنتم لا تشعرون. إن الذين يغضون أصواتهم عند رسول الله أولئك الذين امتحن الله قلوبهم للتقوى لهم مغفرة وأجر عظيم. إن الذين ينادونك من وراء الحجرات أكثرهم لا يعقلون ولو أنهم صبروا حتى تخرج إليهم لكان خيرا لهم والله غفور رحيم.
Okay, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. This chapter, which is chapter 49 from the Quran, is a Madani chapter. And as you all aware of, that there are certain differences between the Madani surahs and the Makki surahs. The Makki surahs do not have many commandments and details of the Islamic law. And they are focusing on matters of aqidah and belief in Allah Jalla wa Ala and the hereafter. While the Madani surahs include many commandments and legislations. That's why if you see any legislation that talk about riba, for example, the prohibition of riba, or that talks about fasting, or other kind of legislations, normally it is a Madani surah. Moreover, the Makki surahs normally have very short verses, while the Madani surahs have long verses. And these are known for everyone who studies Quran in general and studies the differences between different chapters in the Quran. This chapter is a Madani chapter. Madani chapter means it has been revealed after the migration of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam to Medina. And this chapter has 18 verses and 5 nida'at, 5 verses in which Allah Jalla wa Ala is calling the believers, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, and one time where Allah Jalla wa Ala is addressing the whole mankind, Ya ayyuhal nasu inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha wa ja'alnakum shu'uban wa qabaila lita'arafu. And despite that, this surah has 18 verses, is a very concise surah that dealt with number of adab and etiquettes. And we see that the Quran's approach is a very amazing approach. It is unlike any discussion where Allah Jalla wa Ala is mixing in one verse matters related to aqidah, matters related to akhlaq, matters related to our social life. In fact, you will see that in one particular verse, Allah Jalla wa Ala is talking about law of governance. Allah Jalla wa Ala is talking about politics. Allah Jalla wa Ala is talking about how we conduct ourselves. And Allah Jalla wa Ala is connecting all of this to what? To aqidah, to believe in Him and in the hereafter. This surah started by this verse, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِنْ جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ بِنَبَأٍ فَتَبَيَّنُوا أَنْ تُصِيبُوا قَوْمًا بِجَهَالَةٍ فَتُصْبِحُوا عَلَى مَا فَعَلْتُمْ مِنَ الْدِّيمِينَ. You haven't read the translation. Can you please read the translation?
Mm-hmm. O you who believed, do not put yourselves before Allah and His Messenger, but fear Allah. Indeed, Allah is hearing and knowing. O you who have believed, do not raise your voices above the voice of the Prophet or be loud to him in speech, like the loudness of some of you to others, lest your deeds become worthless while you perceive not. Indeed, those who lower their voices before the Messenger of Allah, they are the ones whose hearts Allah has tested for righteousness. For them is forgiveness and great reward. Indeed, those who call you, O Muhammad, from those behind the chambers, most of them do not use reason. And if they had been patient until you could come out to them, it would have been better for them. But Allah is forgiving and merciful.
So this surah started by this verse, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تُقَدِّمُوا بَيْنَ يَدَيِ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِي. O you who believe, do not put yourselves before Allah Jalla wa Ala and His Messenger. The basic meaning of this ayah, which is a very fundamental ayah, which deals with a very fundamental principle in our deen, in our Islam, that all you who believe, don't suggest a ruling before Allah Jalla wa Ala and His Messenger. What does that mean? It means that before you say that Islam should be like this or Islam should be like that, you should listen to what Allah Jalla wa Ala and His Messenger are saying about this particular issue, and then you have no choice but to implement the other ayah, إِنَّمَا كَانَ قَوْلَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذَا دُعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ لِيَحْكُمَ بَيْنَهُمْ أَنْ يَقُولُوا سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. After you hear what Allah Jalla wa Ala and His Messenger confirm, then you have to say, we hear and we obey. Don't even negate that, or don't argue with that. So this ayah is saying two things. don't recommend something to be Sharia. And once you listen to it, you need to submit to it. And this is the essence of Islam. The essence of the word Islam is submission. It's not only peace, or it is not peace as many people think, the word Islam. The word Islam means submission. It means that you submit to the will of Allah Jalla wa Ala. So if Allah Jalla wa Ala decided something, you don't suggest anything opposite to what Allah Jalla wa Ala decreed. And if you see this ayah and you reflect upon it, you will see that we are not implementing this ayah, because sometimes we might not like many Islamic maxims or guidelines, and then we say Islam should be like this, Islam should be like that. No, this is Islam, this is not Islam, while we are ignorant of the reality of Islam. So this ayah is dealing with a very fundamental principle in Islam, which is what? We take Islam from Allah and His Messenger. We do not take Islam from our whims and desires. We do not suggest what Islam should be before we study what Islam is really about. Then Allah Jalla wa Ala says after this, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَرْفَعُوا أَصْوَاتَكُمْ فَوْقَ صَوْتِ النَّبِيِّ. This is a continuation of the first principle. Allah Jalla wa Ala is addressing believers that they should observe certain etiquettes when they deal with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away. So what is the etiquette that we should deal with what? With the legacy of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. We should not raise our voices against the legacy of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So this can be taken metaphorically as well. And some scholars said that the honor of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, should be honored when he was alive, and he should be honored in his grave after his death sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So whenever we visit him, we should visit him while we are humbling ourselves before him sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. In front of his grave, which means that once we visit his grave, we should not have loud voices, and we should conduct ourselves, and we should behave ourselves. Now, other than this, many scholars said that if the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam is being recited, we should respect that, and we should not oppose the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the legacy of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Moreover, many scholars said if there is a discussion about a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then people should behave themselves. They should sit properly. They should talk properly. They should not raise their voices above the voice of the person who is reciting the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, out of respect for what? For the legacy of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And same thing, of course, have to be done towards the Quran. And here, this is a matter of tarbiyah. Look at many of majalis al-ilm when we study. When, for example, the teacher says something that we do not understand, immediately we ask the teacher loudly, or maybe we laugh loudly, or we do not sit properly in the presence of a teacher who is teaching the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is not the respect for the teacher himself, rather it is the respect more. It is the respect for what the teacher is teaching. Of course, we have to have a respect for the teacher, but most importantly, respect for what the teacher is teaching, and in particular, if he is teaching the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, or the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Okay, this would be enough in these ayat, and then inshallah we will move to the second part of those ayat. As I told you, that we are not going through each word or each verse, because of time, we will go through the theme of each part of the surah. Yes.
يا أيها الذين آمنوا إن جاءكم فاسق بنبأ فتبينوا أن تصيبوا قوما بجهالة فتصبحوا على ما فعلتم نادمين واعلموا أن فيكم رسول الله لو يطيعكم في كثير من الأمر لعنتم ولكن الله حبب إليكم الإيمان وزينه في قلوبكم وكره إليكم الكفر والفسوق والعصيان أولئك هم الراشدون فضلا من الله ونعمة والله عليم حكيم.
O you have believed, if there comes to you a disobedient one with information, investigate, lest you harm a people out of ignorance and become over what you have done regretful. And know that among you is the messenger of Allah. If he were to obey you in much of the matter, you would be in difficulty. But Allah has endeared to you the faith and has made it pleasing in your hearts and has made hateful to you disbelief, defiance, and disobedience. Those are the rightly guided. It is as bounty from Allah and favor, and Allah is knowing and wise.
Okay. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. This is another theme of the surah. Allah Jalla wa Ala is addressing believers here to have the proper etiquette in dealings with rumors. So Allah Jalla wa Ala says, if a non-trustworthy person came to you, he's a fasiq, wrongdoer, with information, don't act upon those information immediately, but you need to what? You need to investigate and verify. So this is the main theme. This is the general meaning of this ayah. As you can see, that this is a very profound meaning. And we have so many problems in our community because we are not implementing this. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prohibited us from qila wa qal, just passing rumors without investigating whether those rumors are true or untrue. And we start spreading those rumors without any kind of investigation. This will cause harm within the society. That's why Allah Jalla wa Ala says, you have to investigate. Many scholars said that this ayah includes investigation in general before starting passing rumors or passing any kind of information that you are not quite sure whether this information is authentic information, then you should not do it unless you confirm that. Subhanallah, from an academic perspective, they say that you cannot quote a secondary source. You have to investigate whether this information is in the primary source. You have to refer to the primary sources, not the secondary sources. Why? Because you need to investigate that this information is a correct information. Then Allah Jalla wa Ala says, know that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam is there among you. Whether the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in person, he is among you, or his sunnah is among you. Is his sunnah, his legacy is among you. And if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam were to obey you on whatever you suggest, what will happen? This will cause difficulty upon you. What does that mean? It means, and this refers to the beginning of the surah, that don't suggest something before Allah and his messenger. Why? Allah Jalla wa Ala is explaining one of those reasons, which is here. If we were to suggest to suggest everything or to just suggest anything before Allah and His Messenger, or recommend that Islam should be like this or like that, or recommend that Sharia should change and should be like this or that, this will incur hardship on ourselves. Why? Because the legislation of Allah Jalla wa Ala is the best legislation for the whole humanity. So if Allah Jalla wa Ala is telling us, if we were to change Sharia because of you, according to your whims, this will cause harm to you before anything. That's why Allah Jalla wa Ala says, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is between you. He is there. If he is not there, then his legacy is there. Follow his legacy. That's it. لا تقدموا بين يدي الله ورسولي. Then Allah Jalla wa Ala says, it is Allah who made you loving this iman, and He beautified iman in your hearts, and He is the one who make you hate kufr. He is the one who makes you hating kufr and disliking kufr at all. Those people who are following this, they are the guided people. Allah Jalla wa Ala here is reminding us that it is His favor that He made us those people who like iman. And that's why the person should be keen to ask Allah Jalla wa Ala to be guided and to be a person who what? Who likes iman. And here we have to be careful that any favor is from Allah Jalla wa Ala. However, if someone were to say that he does not like iman, he does not like Allah and His Messenger, he cannot put that blame on Allah Jalla wa Ala. He should put it on himself. Why? Because he is the one who rejected Allah and His Messenger, and Allah Jalla wa Ala guided him to both paths. But he chose not to like Allah and His Messenger. However, if there is a favor upon us, then that favor is from Allah Jalla wa Ala. So the favor is from Allah Jalla wa Ala, and if there is any negative thing that we feel about Allah and His Messenger, this is from ourselves, not from Allah Jalla wa Ala. This is from ourselves or from the shaitan, not from Allah Jalla wa Ala. And then Allah Jalla wa Ala says, فَضْلًا مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَنِعْمَةٌ وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ حَكِيمٌ. Allah Jalla wa Ala favors anyone with any favor he wanted. Allah Jalla wa Ala is all-knowing. Allah Jalla wa Ala is all-wise. Allah Jalla wa Ala, He knows who deserves His bounties, His favors, and Allah Jalla wa Ala knows who does not deserve His bounties and favors. Socially, Muslims, all Muslims, wherever they are brothers. What does that mean? It means I should feel the sense of brotherhood towards you. You should feel the sense of brotherhood towards me. تجري بنور في الحياة جديد.